Okay, so this is the movie that pretty much gave Schumacher the name as the man who destroyed and killed the Batman franchise. Joel Schumacher was harshly criticized by fans, critics, comic book lovers everywhere. He has been made fun of in some certain shows, including Animaniacs. And this is a film where he personally went out and apologized and took full responsibility for a disaster film. I'm just going to go out and say this, guys. You may not like it. That's fine. But I do not give all the blame to Schumacher for making this film the way it was. Yes, I say it again, he was the director. Yes, he was in charge of the actors and making sure the screen, the script was tidy up and good and all and whatnot. I am not disputing that. But I want people to understand something. Warner Brothers did not care to make a darker, edgier film. Warner Brothers only cared about marketing their merchandise, their toys, their video games, anything that was connected to the Batman and Robin movie. That's all they care about. They wanted to sell merchandise. This was only a vehicle to do that. And as a result of that, they basically threw out anything out there, made it as marketable as possible for children, just so they can sell their new line of toys. Many people brought this up about that. This was pretty much a film that Warner Brothers never took seriously. And it, to my opinion, this hurt a lot of other comic book movies down the road. It took perhaps maybe Blade to actually get people to be serious about comic book movies again. That's how long it was. This film really, it was pretty much a joke. For a very while, comic book movies was getting to be worse and worse, and Batman pretty much solidified that with Batman and Robin. Spider-Man pretty much brought comic book back to life, even though Blade was the one that took it, that showed that you can make a serious badass comic book adaptation. Spider-Man was the one that actually showed, with the right balance and the right talent actors, you can actually can make comic book mainstream and for everyone. This film, not so much. I'm not gonna go too much into the story because it's a lot of people pretty much know the gist of it. what this film is pretty much tied into, why Mr. Freeze is doing what he's doing, which makes no sense at all. He's robbing museums to get diamonds because of the power of his suit, also to support his wife who is stuck in cryogenic freeze. You have Poison Ivy, who's, you know, was this geek science person who was working alongside Joan Glover, aka Lionel Luthor, in the future, and he tried to kill her, throwing a bath of all these chemicals. Real cliche hideout, real cliche mad science, bad guy, lightning strike, all that kind of stuff. And the toxic that she had became, didn't kill her, but it made her into this new villain known as Poison Ivy. Those are the kind of things. Next thing you know, she's like against what the doctor's doing because it's evil. And all of a sudden, she's become evil by one or two rule the world, which makes no sense. I'm not even going to talk about Bane. The simple fact is, that is not Bane to me. I got back into comic books, and the first thing I read about was the Nightfall series, how Batman got broken. Right up to that new Batman they had for a while, which I never followed. I didn't even like how they portrayed him, and I'm like, thank goodness Bruce Wayne miraculously healed himself and got back into the spat suit, because that character got on my last nerves. In any case, once I saw what they did to Bane, I didn't even know Bane was supposed to be in this movie, until I saw the film. I'm like, wow, Bane is here in this movie, and I'm kind of wish he wasn't, because that's not Bane. I don't know what the hell that was, but I'll just leave it at B. And the only another reason why I'm not going to say too much about it, he didn't have much of a major role in this film, other than the fact that he was the Bodyguard of Poison Ivy, and that's the Bodyguard of Poison Ivy, and just said bombs. That's pretty much it. Where do I start with this film? Because there's really so much that I can actually rip into. I feel bad ripping into a film like this, but this film so much disappointed me. I expected this film to be cheesy and campy. I didn't expect it to be this bad. I think that the suit up pretty much got everybody aware that, oh, they're going to be in for a ride. Because we pretty much, if you've seen if you guys noticed the last Joel Schumacher film, and I got something to say about this, because I did a little research on it, and I'm pretty much catching why this kind of stuff that this kind of innuendo actually happened, because I did read up on the director, because I did like his other work. I liked the Flatliners. He did a very good job with that film, and there were other work that I actually did enjoy, and I will review, because they were actually impressively good. And he's actually is the writer for an upcoming movie with Whitney Houston called Sparkles. So he's not a terrible director. I mean, he's definitely not a terrible writer, but when it came to this film, it pretty much set him back a lot. He actually went away from mainstream for a very long time because of that one film, and I feel kind of bad, because again, I don't put all the blame on him. I actually got to give Warner Brothers just as much as blame. So where do I start? I might as well start with the dialogue. It is just terribly bad. I mean, it is so bad that it's actually laughable how much unconventional dialogue there was. From the Batman saying stuff that got me scratching my head to I can't get this guy's name now. From Robin, Chris O'Donnell, who I liked from the first film. I thought he was good. In this one, they made him annoying. I did not like his betrayal in this one. I'm like, what happened? Why can't you just be the same way as you was the last film? This film, they made him into an annoying person. Granted, I understand that they had a little bit of odds. Batman still wants to control things. He wants to control death. He wants to make sure that this is my way, the highway, because he's trying to protect Dick Gracie from getting killed, because he is kind of reckless in many ways. But that all the more made his character more annoying, because we are aware that, yeah, he is reckless, and he really hasn't shown how to become responsible, especially when he almost got himself killed right in the beginning of the movie. So I kind of, you know, I didn't really understand why was there really a major conflict, when reality was he was reckless in many ways. And his character just completely ignores me. I had nothing to say about, I already said enough about Commissioner Gordon. I'm not even going to go any further. He became dumbed down completely in this film. And I never even really cared for him in the first Batman movie. And this one, I just gave up. I totally gave up. I gave up on Batman Forever. I didn't even bother with his performance. He just got dumbed down completely in this performance. And that's all I gotta say. And this is kind of a shame, because the actor who played Commissioner Gordon is a good actor. He has a very good resume. Just in this, I just felt he was completely wasted, where he could have been a lot more. And I also further note why Gary Oldman's performance would be deeply missed when they reboot the Batman franchise again. I guess the one role that really, I think, pissed off a lot of comic book fans, including myself, I'm not even gonna lie on that, was not Mr. Freeze, not Poison Ivy, Olivia Silverstone as Batgirl. And the reason why is, everybody knows, unless they was going to the very, very first Batgirl, because it wasn't commission, it wasn't on Barbara Gordon who was the first Batgirl. It was somebody else, and she has completely been erased from time. When they betrayed her as Alfred's niece, and she supposed to have this British accent, not one time I was convinced. I didn't like this her betrayal as Batgirl at all. And which is kind of a shame, because I actually like Olivia Silverstone's films when I was growing up. I thought they were actually surprisingly good films. and this was the movie that ended her career. I have not seen her in anything else after this film. I know she did other things outside of Hollywood, which I'm glad that she actually did other things besides being on the big screen. But this was the film that basically killed her career. She had not able to have a promising career after this film, and it was not too hard to see why. This film showed her performance in a poorest of quality. I looked at this character and said, why she's in this film again? Why is she donning the suit again? What the real purpose of her becoming Batgirl again? I never really got into this character. In fact, the more she was on screen, the more annoying I got. Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, besides the bat puns and all, I did not expect him to do much. If I saw Tommy Lee Jones' performance, and once I saw the trailer, it was clear that I can't take this Freeze seriously. It was not going to be like the Freeze that I actually grown to respect and loved. I love Mr. Freeze's character in the animated series. And seeing the trailer for this movie, I said, don't give up hope that this is going to be taken, this character going to be taken seriously. And when I saw it, no surprise, it was Arnold Schwarzenegger plus the puns. So, that was pretty much it. All I got to say about this, how it became Mr. Freeze was explained briefly and stupidly, of course. But I can't really fault Arnold Schwarzenegger. Even himself, he was not very happy at being cast that way either. So it's just what it is. I mean, to be honest with you, Arnold Schwarzenegger at the time when he was there, I actually liked seeing him in the film. I mean, he didn't really piss me off as let's just say the other stuff that was going on in the film, the bad credit card, which still scratched a lot of people's heads to this day. The bickering between those two, the terrible dialogue that was thrown all out there, this new world that I'm supposed to be taking seriously. But I guess the one thing that hurt this film the most is the fact that there was no real strong story to go with this movie. There was no real threat that I really seen justified. I didn't understand why Poison Ivy wants to rule the world. I guess that's because she's Poison Ivy now and she has to rule the world. Uma Thurman's punchlines really pissed me off in this film. But overall, she was still sexy. She was still... I still wanted to see her on screen. And a lot of people actually thought her performance was alright. So, there that is. The one thing I will say that I actually did like with this film, besides the score, I thought the score was alright. I had no problem with the score. Was the fact that there was a connection, there was a more story with Alfred. I actually like the fact that the Alfred Bruce Wayne connection was actually explored a lot more. And like I said, the one thing I give Schumacher credit is he made Alfred more involved in these last two films that he did than any of the Tim Burton films. I mean, yeah, he was there, but to me he was not as liked within the Tim Burton movies as he was in the Schumacher films, and I explain why. Remember that scene where he like escorted Vicki Vale into the Batcave and Batman didn't get mad? You know who got mad the most? The fans. The fans were pissed. I mean, I'm telling you, people made parodies of that. Cartoon animated series, Tiny Toon Adventures made parodies of that. And that's because people were really, like, upset. They're like, Alfred would never do that. Why did he do that? What purpose did he did that? Even I was questioning that. I was like, why did you just send this girl to the Batcave? There's a reason why it's hidden for no one to know about it. So it just didn't make any sense. And it never was explained. I was at least happy that Bruce Wayne at least acknowledged how stupid that was when he went back to the Batcave and said, Vicki Vale, you put him that there. When I turn around, I see Vicki Vale right next to me in the Batcave. So he did acknowledge how dumb that was. I think it was some burden way of saying, all right, guys, my bad, I understand that. it pissed you off. I'm sorry. And just to show how I'm sorry, I'm going to put this in the scene. But when he went to Jerry Schumacher, I think he wanted to explore more on this character than I originally expected. And I actually thought that was the strength of this film. I actually did like the interactions with Bruce Wayne and Alfred in this film more than anything else. I think this popularity, that actor who played him, which passed away not too long ago, God rest his soul, his popularity actually jumped with the Schumacher films more than the Tim Burton films. And I have to give credit to where credit is due. I think Schumacher did a good job of developing Alfred a lot more than what he probably would have gotten with Tim Burton. Other than that, besides that, and the pacing wasn't bad. The pacing was never was terrible. I never thought the film dragged. It's just everything else that happened in this film, with the puns, with the way that dialogue was presented. And these are good actors. These are not terrible actors that are saying these dialogues. I think he went way too much in trying to make it campy, cheesy, make it more like the movie, like the Tim Burton film, that it became insulting towards, not only towards the older Batman movies, but for even the children, because I know a lot of kids were like, it's stupid, but you know what, I kind of wish it was other like the other Batman films. I know when I watched it, there were some kids who liked it, Dumb Points and Ivy, there were some kids who actually liked it, the grand color of things, but no one actually, when the film was over, after a while, they don't talk about it again. That's how bad this film was. It was just a disappointing film. Do I think this is the worst of the worst? Honestly, no, I don't. I still have Captain America 1990 as my worst comic book film I've ever seen in my life. I don't consider this as the worst of the worst. I don't consider this as the worst film ever made. Because when I saw this film, I gave it 2.5 stars. And guess what? If I rate it now, it's probably going to lose that half a star. But to me, it did have some respectable qualities to it that I actually did enjoy. It's just, there was so much bad this time around. It just became very disappointing. I expected better from the film. I didn't expect Schumacher to give me a darker, serious Batman, because it was clear that he couldn't. But I expected something that at least can be entertaining. And this was, to me, is bad, but it's entertainingly bad. It's not something that I go out and say, I actually hate this film. I actually despise this. How can Schumacher do this? Because honestly, I didn't. I might be lying to you if I said that I did that. Honestly, I didn't. I looked at the film and I said, wow, what a disappointment. And I was just hoping that when he did, because he was signed to do Batman Triumphant. He was him. George Clooney was supposed to come back. Even Chris O'Donnell. Actually, he campaigned that he wanted to be in another Batman film. He really liked the franchise more than anybody else. But unfortunately, and even though this is why I say he didn't kill the franchise, this movie made money. It made a lot of money. That's not the reason why they halted production. The cry from comic book lovers, moviegoers, Bat fans was so loud. There was no way they could have done that film. There was no way they could have done the film the same way they did Batman and Robin. They realized that they went extremely down. They went lowest as you can possibly go. This was the low point in the Batman franchise, and they had to pretty much halt it. That film, they had to halt it. Batman 5. They had no choice but to halt the Batman 5, because there was no way that moviegoers, including fans alike, was going to take another cheesy, crappy, made-for-marketing only film, especially with the money that was that they were asking to shell out at that time. It just no way it was going to happen. Because I remember reading about this movie, reading about Triumphant, and it was doing the casting call for it, and it was talk about Scarecrow maybe in there, Harley Quinn, which was supposed to be the Joker's daughter, was supposed to be in this. There was so much ideas pushing in there, and all that came to a screeching halt where they said, we got to rethink the Batman universe, and there was so much out there, starting with Batman Beyond, because Batman Beyond was such a huge hit on television that they was actually thinking about, let's make it into the movie. That fell through. Batman Year One was talking about, and that fell through. Although a lot of people was kind of wishing they actually kept that that idea in the forefront. And the only reason why I think they probably fell through because Frank Miller's Batman was so dark that it was no way they could have got a PG-13. If that film actually came to life. So they went to the next best thing and just basically reboot the whole franchise. Batman Begins, Chris Nolan, and as you all know, the rest is history. Again, I'm going to keep it as 2.5 stars. That's the rating I gave this film, and that's the one I'm going to keep. And the reason is it's bad, but I still had some entertaining qualities to it. I didn't walk out of there just pissed off. It just was something that was, it was dumbed down to the point where it just, you know, it was just disappointing. I was very disappointed. But I don't go out and say that it was that Schumacher. I was surprised at how, when I first heard about the reaction towards this film. Because keep in mind, when I watch films, there's only like a few critics I actually watched just for the fun of it. Cisco and Ebert, of course, was one of them. There was another one at the movies on Channel 11 that was came on and it got canceled recently. But those were the only critics I actually listened to. But it was the other critics, the moviegoers, that just ripped this film apart, and I'm like, really? You guys thought it was that bad? And I didn't see it. I was a teenager when I saw it too. I was in my late teens when I saw it. I just didn't see it was that horrible. Yes, when you watch it now, you just shake your head and wondering why, what the hell it is. But I can still find some fun qualities to it. Now, as for Joel Schumacher's, I almost forgot to mention this because I know my time here. There was a lot of reasons why we saw those in the window when we see bat ass and bat nipples. According to a lot of reports, and this isn't something that's not new, you can actually look it up. Schumacher, I believe, is bisexual. And I think that the stuff that that you saw kind of represent that a little bit. Not to say that that was his intentions to, but I pretty much notice a lot especially with certain directors, especially with Nightmare 2, because it was only just a few years ago when I looked back at that movie and why we saw so much in the windows in that film, that it was later revealed that the actor was homosexual, and that the director pretty much reflected that. Don't ask me why. Again, I could be wrong on that, but I wouldn't be surprised if that was the reason why we seen what we saw, all these close-ups. Keep them, you know, it's something to be mindful of. Other than that, to me, I don't think Joel Schumacher is a terrible director at all. I've seen some of his work. I actually think there are some work that I actually admire. And I advise you guys to check out some of his earlier work, as well as some of the work he did after Batman. You'd be surprised at how well done they are. They are very, very good work. So to say he's a bad director and have people make fun of him saying he's a terrible director, I think it's a little unfair. I think they're only basing it on one film. And even with this film, I didn't think he did a horrible job, and I think that he shouldn't take the responsibility of all the stuff that didn't work in his movie. I do respect him tremendously for him coming out and say, hey, it's my fault, you know, blame it on me, I apologize for that. But to say that he was the actual reason why Batman died during that time period, I have to put that a lot on Warner Brothers, because they really didn't took this film seriously. They looked at it as money, money, money. I want to sell this, I want to sell that, make this movie so we can sell this and now that. I don't care about the script, I don't care about how the dialogue sound like. We want to make this marketable. We want kids to buy our stuff. We want kids to buy the Happy Meals that's connected to our stuff. That's what we care about. That's all we want to care about. Make it possible. And so we had the two films that we had. Other than that, there's really nothing else I can say about the film. It's up 2.5. That's all I got to say. And as far as I'm concerned, it's not terrible. It's just disappointing. That's all I got to say for now. This is Jay77. Hey, take care and be safe.